Friends, today we will study about the prostate gland. So, already yesterday we have studied about the urinary bladder, and after the urinary bladder, we will study the prostate gland to see its relations, its location, its lobes of the prostate gland, and what are the surfaces and what is the function of this prostate gland. Everything detail we'll study. So please watch till the end to get all the things along with the clinical anatomy. So as you know that the prostate gland, here you can see, is the gland that is an encapsulated fibromuscular and glandular solid organ which mainly surrounds the beginning of the male urethra. It's thin and milky alkaline secretion which neutralizes the acid secretion of the vagina is added to the seminal fluid at the time of ejaculation. So it is about 4 cm wide, 3 cm long and 2 cm thick and weight about 8 gram. So the prostate is a cone shaped, here you can see. So as you can see here, the prostate gland, so this is the urinary bladder. The posterior surface of the urinary bladder, here you will find the seminal vesicle, and here you will find the ductus deferens and the vas deferens over here. Then at this point we will find this conical shape organ is the prostate. So it is about the size of a chestnut and is made up of the connective tissue and smooth muscles. It measures about, as already I have told you, 1.6 inch from side to side or 4 cm and about 1.2 inch from top to bottom, or you can say 3 cm, and about 2 cm its thickness is in, you can say, from front to back. So it is inferior to the urinary bladder, and it surrounds the prostatic urethra. So here at this point you'll find neck of the bladder, then the pre-prostatic urethra, and this part is the prostatic urethra, and below you'll find here the urogenital diaphragm. So the urogenital diaphragm is the inferior lesion, and superior lesion will be the urinary bladder. So if you'll see the location of this gland, so the prostate lies in the lesser pelvis, below and behind the pubic symphysis, in between the neck of the bladder and the upper surface of the urogenital diaphragm, as you can see here in this figure. And it is behind the pubic arch and in front of the ampulla of the rectum, and it is like an inverted flat and conical structure and has a base, an apex, and posterior, anterior, and two inferolateral surfaces. The two ejaculatory ducts which carry the sperm and the fluid secreted by the seminal vesicles that converge and narrow in the center of the prostate and unite with the urethra. The urethra then continues to the lower segment of the prostate and exits near the apex. So this gland is surrounded by the urethra, and the duct that serves for this passage of both the urine and the semen. So if you'll see the surface and parts of the gland, so the parts of the glands, they are mainly the base, which is cephaloid against the neck of the bladder, and the base is directed upwards and is continuous with the neck of the bladder. The urethra enters the base near its anterior border and descends vertically close to the anterior surface. The two ejaculatory ducts that already have seen in the previous image that pierces the base near its posterior border and run obliquely downwards and forward to open in the prostatic urethra in each side of the prostatic utricle. The apex is directed chorded against the urogenital diaphragm. So here we'll see in this image that you can see the apex over here. So the apex is directed downward and lies on the superior fascia of the urogenital diaphragm covering the sphincter urethri. This is the point you have to remember. So from the apex of the prostate, the urethra comes out and continues as the membranous part of the urethra in the deep perineal space. It has the surfaces, like you can say the posterior surface, which is flat and is marked by the distinct vertical median groove. So this groove begins above in a depression at the base of the prostate, where you will find the two ejaculatory ducts that enters the prostate gland and it is palpable per rectal examination. If you do the rectal examination, you can palpate this ducts against these glands at the posterior surface of the glands. And this posterior surface is related to the lowest part of the rectum and rectal ampulla, as you can see here in this picture. It is separated from the rectum by the sheath of the prostate, which is formed by the rectovesical fascia. The rectovesical pouch that you will find here in the prenatal life, it extends up to the perineal body. Later on, the two layers of this peritoneum of the lower part of the rectovesical pouch that fuse and form the rectovesical fascia, which extends superiorly up to the seminal vesicle and inferiorly up to the perineal body. Then we'll see the anterior surface. It is about 2 cm behind the pubic symphysis and extends from the base to the apex, and it is related to the retropubic fat that already you have seen during the study of the urinary bladder. So here you will find the puboprostatic ligament, which are attached to its upper part of the anterior surface. Then you will find here the inferolateral surface. So the inferolateral surface, they are related and supported by the anterior part of this levator ani and forms the levator prostati. A plexus of veins that lies over this surface, and you will find the two inferolateral surfaces meet at the anterior border of the prostate. Then you will see the lobes of the prostate or lobe of the prostate gland. So as you can see here, the prostate can be divided into 5 lobes through no definitive lobulation is seen either inside or outside the gland, but we will divide it into mainly the 4 parts, that is the anterior lobe, as you can see here. So this anterior lobe lies in front of the urethra and consists of fibromuscular tissue which connects the right and left lateral lobes. It contains less glandular tissue. Here you can see the posterior lobe that lies behind the prostatic urethra and median lobe and is in between the two lateral lobes. It comes in contact with the rectum and presents the median groove, and it is predisposed to mainly the cancer, the primary cancer. Then we'll find the two lateral lobes. So the two lateral lobes lie on each side of the urethra and are related to the levator ani, and they contain large amount of the glandular tissue, and the adenoma develops in these lobes. The median lobe, which is below the neck of the bladder and lies between the upper part of the prostatic urethra and the ejaculatory ducts. And here we'll see the median lobe that is actually wedge shaped, whose apex is at the colliculus seminalis in the prostatic urethra, and the base is at the neck of the bladder. Its base produces an elevation, that is the uvula. The base produces an elevation, that is the uvula vesici, posterior to the internal urethral openings. In old age, you will find when the median lobe will become hypertrophied, the urethra is pushed forward and the growth projects into the bladder. So if you will see the structure of this prostate, there mainly the greater portion of the prostate consists of mainly the glandular tissue, which is mixed with the fibromuscular tissue. So if we will open the prostate from the front, you can identify the urethral crest, the prostatic sinus and the seminal colliculus. So here you will find this is your colliculus seminalis, and here you will find the pelvic urethral muscles. So the seminal colliculus, it is slightly enlarged part of the urethral crest which opens the ejaculatory duct and an embryonic remnant of the prostatic utricle. So here you will find the urethral crest, and here you will find the prostatic sinus, or you can see the seminal colliculus. So this one just we have enlarged here to see its structures clearly. So the prostatic sinus that will find here, that is a small valleys along side of the crest into which the prostatic ducts they open. So if you'll see the arterial supply, or the mainly the arteries, all the arteries they supplying the prostate are the inferior vesicle, middle rectal and internal pudendal arteries. So here you'll find the internal iliac artery. From the internal iliac artery, here you'll find the inferior vesicle artery. So that this inferior vesicle artery, it gives blood supply to the urinary bladder, and also it supplies to the prostate over here. And here you will find these arteries, they are known as the urethral group of arteries, and you will find the capsular group of arteries, and you will find that branch from the middle hemorrhoidal and pudendal arteries. Here you will find the left lateral lobe, and that also supplied by the inferior vesicle arteries. So the prostatic venous plexus is actually the anterior to the prostate and behind the lower part of the pubic symphysis and lies in the fascial sheath of the prostate, and it receives deep dorsal vein of the penis, and the plexus drains into the internal iliac and inferior vesical veins. Superiorly, the prostatic plexus is connected with the vesical venous plexus, and it also communicates with the vertebral venous plexus. If you see the lymphatic drainage, the lymphatic from the prostate that drains into the internal iliac and the sacral nodes. So the arterial blood supply to the seminal vessels and ductus deferens comes from the differential artery or the artery of the ductus, a branch that is from the superior vesical artery. The inferior vesical artery, it gives two main branches to feed the prostate. Then the nerve supply, as you can see here, the nerve is mainly from the inferior hypogastric plexus, which receives sympathetic fibers from the L1 and L2 segments, and the parasympathetic fibers from S2 to S4 segments of the spinal cord. So the clinical points, as you can, you have to remember here, that is the prostatitis. So the prostatitis is mainly the inflammation of the prostate, sometimes caused by the infection, and it is typically treated with antibiotics. In some patients, you will find the enlarged prostate that is called as the benign prostatic hypertrophy or the BPH. So the prostate growth affects virtually all men over the 50 years of the age, and symptoms mainly the difficulty in urination, that mainly cured by either by the medicines or by the surgery to treat this benign prostatic hypertrophy. Or we can do the prostatectomy. Prostatectomy means removal of the prostate, so which relieves the obstruction during the enucleation of the prostate. Its capsule should be preserved so that the venous plexus around the gland is not injured. The median lobe enlargement cannot be detected by the rectal examination because it is present at the center, but it can be detected by the ultrasonography or by the cystoscopy. So the prostatectomy can be done by the transurethral route through the urethra, or by the suprapubic transvisceral through the bladder exposed extraperitoneally in the suprapubic region, and also we can approach through the retropubic, directly through the retropubic space, or we can approach through the perineal, from the perineum through the rectovesical fascia. The transurethral approach is the most common nowadays, and the perineal is the uncommon. So the carcinoma of the prostate, carcinoma of prostate usually occurs in old age in the posterior lobe, and the posterior and hard malignant nodes, as you can see here, they are palpable per rectal examination. Its spread takes place through the lymph vessels to internal iliac and to the common iliac nodes. It also the metastasis in the vertebral column through the bulbous veins, it connecting to the prostatic venous plexus with vertebral venous plexus. So the cancer cells, that they can also reach the skull through this route. Serious bleeding during the retropubic retropubic prostatectomy occurs due to the injury to prostatic venous plexus. So thank you for watching. Here we have completed the prostate gland and all its structures and the arterial supply, lymphatic drainage and the clinical anatomy. So thanks for watching.